I feel like I have a completely useless memory. I can barely remember a phone number when someone reads it off to me, and I'll never be any good at cards because I have no recollection of which cards I've already had, what's been discarded, really anything that just happened. Which is why it's so wild to read about memory athletes, people who can memorize entire decks of shuffled cards, or even bigger sets of data. In 2015, a guy in India recited 70,000 digits of pi for the Guinness Book of World Records. From memory. So what's the difference between him and me? What would I need to go from forgetting 7 digits to remembering 70,000? Well, first, that's not actually a fair comparison. There are lots of different kinds of memory. For example, to hear a phone number and then dial it yourself, you need working memory. That's the data you can keep and process in the front of your mind spontaneously. And it's not a lot of data. Back in 1956, a famous psychology paper called The Magical Number 7, plus or minus 2, suggested that there's a limit to what working memory can handle, somewhere around 7 items at a time. That doesn't seem like much, but try it. Ask a friend to read you 7 random numbers and then repeat them right back.
8294691.
8294637.
8296431. That's all I got.
Now, since 1956, a lot of research has sort of muddied this claim of the magical number 7. For one thing, people may instinctively chunk those numbers up into groups, which makes recall a lot easier. And in fact, try that same little experiment again, but this time, chop 7 numbers up into a standard phone number.
4528961.
4528961.
4528961. Was that great? Was that 100%? I got it.
Other studies have pointed out, too, that the magic number can be totally different when you're talking about words or objects. So all of this might be an oversimplification. But most of the research out there does point to a hard limit on working memory. So what about those 70,000 digits of pi? For that kind of task, we're talking more about long-term memory. And long-term memory storage is enormous. Like, we don't even know how big enormous. But try sitting down with a printout of pi and just going for it. There may not be limits to memory storage, but there are clearly limits to how we do the remembering and the recalling. But unlike working memory, we can do something about it.
So you can learn to have a better memory, but you have to train the right way.
Here's Verge Science reporter Rachel Becker.
All right. Researchers wanted to figure out if you could train someone to have a better memory. So they scanned the brains of people like you and me and a bunch of people who compete in memory athletics, like memorizing decks of cards or lists of words, and they found that structurally, the brains were really similar.
Meaning, maybe this was a learned skill, and that's the next part of the study.
So they took a bunch of regular people and they had half of them train just like the memory athletes do. The people who trained for 6 weeks just like the memory athletes did could remember almost as many words as the memory athletes.
So what does memory training look like? Well, say you want to memorize the order of a shuffled deck of cards. This is a common task for memory athletes, and they use a method called the memory palace. A simple version goes like this. First, assign every card an object. The 10 of clubs is a weird stuffed animal. The jack of hearts is a stapler. The 4 of diamonds is a big knife. One object for each of the 52 cards. Then, think of a place you're really familiar with, like your apartment.
All that's just the prep work.
Now, say you've got a fresh deck of shuffled cards to memorize. Deal them out, and as you do, imagine each card's object in a striking, memorable place within your home. A stuffed animal guarding the door handle. A stapler floating in the hallway. A knife tucked into your bed. Again, the weirder the better. Do that 52 times and you can translate the whole deck into your own terrifying student film. I know that doesn't sound like science, and honestly, there's a ton we just don't understand about the neuroscience and all of this. But techniques like the Memory Palace seem to co-opt memory networks that you wouldn't ordinarily use in a card game.
The idea is that this method harnesses the same navigational part of your brain that you would use to memorize how to get to the grocery store just on autopilot. So you're harnessing not only the narrative storytelling memory that you have, but also your navigational memory.
One way or the other, it gets results. Memory athletes use tricks like this to memorize decks of cards, names and faces, and yes, thousands and thousands of digits of pi. And civilians like us maybe could too.
That means that it's not about being born with any sort of special memory gift. It means that you can learn to have a better memory if you train the right way.
So there is some hope for me and my memory. I just have to work at it. And I probably won't get any better at phone numbers. Hey everyone, if you liked this video, make sure to check out the rest of the videos on the channel, and we'll have a new video posted to Verge Science every week. So check back, hit the subscribe button to make sure you see what's new, and thanks for watching.